nobody looks like them, or at least outwardly is expressing that they are like them. The all are welcome thing, the church I served for 13 years as pastor, we had a banner over the door that said all are welcome, and we believed it. I mean, we were a very welcoming church too. But I will tell you that LGBTQ people who walk up to a church and see a banner that says all are welcome, do not assume that that all includes them. Because every church says that everyone's welcome. And too many of us have experienced the church as a place that hurts them. And so all are welcome doesn't mean anything. That doesn't mean nothing, but it doesn't mean what we sometimes think it means. We need to be more explicit. And in fact, I think sometimes I would even go so far as to say churches use it as a way of getting out of the hard conversation or doing the harder thing. And I think we saw that on issues of race during the Black Lives Matter conversation. There are people who want to put up signs that say, all lives matter. And while I understand that the truth of that sentence theologically, people who want to say all lives matter are saying we should not be focusing on black lives. And I think sometimes we can do that around sexuality as well. If we're afraid to mention queerness or being LGBTQIA+, why? And is it because what we're actually saying is that all lives don't matter as much? All right. Charlie is sitting here nervously, and I don't want to make Charlie wait any longer. I think it's really important when we're having these conversations, and some of you said this around the table that I was sitting at lunch, and I really appreciated it, that I can talk about issues all day, sort of what I do. I can talk about doctrine. I can make arguments. But what we sometimes can forget in this work and when we're having these conversations is that we're not really talking about issues. We're not really talking about bullet points in an outline. We're talking about people's lives. We're talking about real people who are going to encounter the risen Christ with us or not. Charlie has agreed to share some of his story, and I am grateful for your willingness to do that, Charlie. So give Charlie a hand.
Thank you all for allowing me to share today. Just get my papers prepared here, I apologize. Good afternoon. As many of you know, my name is Charlie Briggs, and I am a transgender man who has been a member of First Press since I was a young child. I would like to start by reading something on gender that I think so accurately describes it. Jake, 8, transgender, from Central Illinois, from his mom on gender. I've always liked the analogy that a friend of ours made, Hannah Simpson. She compares being transgender to handedness. How do you know you're right or left-handed? No one tells you. You're not born with a mark on your hand telling people which one you are. You just know. When you put something in the wrong hand, you know then too. It just feels wrong, not natural. That's how gender is. When a trans person is walking around the world in the gender they are not, they know it feels wrong. They just know. And when they transition, when they live authentically, it's like picking up that pencil in the correct hand. It feels good. It feels natural and organic and right. Now I would like to take just a few moments to share a little of my journey. Much like the reading I shared said, you hold the pencil in the wrong hand and it just doesn't feel correct. So it was for me every time my mom would put me in a dress growing up. All I wanted was a nice pair of my brother's slacks, his button down, and a tie. That dress just drilled home that I was not in the right body. As I reached my teenage years, a little older, and my brothers began growing facial hair, I remember begging God for my own beard. Look at me now. As I got older, I had my first coming out experience after my divorce. Questioning who I was and noticing an attraction to women, I first came out as lesbian. But upon searching my heart and lots of prayer, I came out as transgender. I remember the Sunday 2.5 years ago when I stood up pensively in this sanctuary and asked this congregation to join me on my journey by calling me by my chosen name, Charlie, and using male pronouns. Since that Sunday, everyone has respected my wishes and has been open and accepting. So much so that just this last summer, this congregation gave me a naming ceremony and reaffirmation of baptismal vows, which I found myself overwhelmed by love and support from a church I will always call home.
Charlie. Wow, thank you so much, Charlie. Thank you for sharing your story. And thanks for being authentic with this congregation. Feel better now?
I do. Love you, Charlie.
Hugs will be dispensed to Charlie after the after the service. Wow. Now see, this is how people will know you're a welcoming congregation. Right? The experience of people being welcomed, transcending fear, transcending years of pain. I'm trying to not put words in Charlie's mouth, but capture what Charlie has said. But answered with love and compassion and acceptance. What an incredible gift, Pastor Ashley, you gave by offering a naming ceremony. What a gift this congregation gave by honoring Charlie's desire to be called by pronouns of his declaration. I'm still wearing a mask. I don't need to be. But the microphone works. What a gift. And this has been a gift to me, so thank you. It's the perfect transition to this idea that there is, in fact, a theology of welcome that is rich and full and authentic. And to me, this is something I've come to in the years that I've been doing this work, that this is about more than justice, although justice is very important and not to be dismissed. It's about more than rights, although equity of rights is absolutely essential in our society. I think this is about nothing less than what we believe about God and how we connect to God. To say someone is welcome in our community or in our church is to say that they, by being here, have access to community. We Presbyterians in particular place this emphasis on what it means to be together to encounter God. Scriptures, where two or three are gathered, there I am among them. From what we believe about communion, what happens at communion? Something unique and special happens. The Holy Spirit is present, not in the bread and the wine, but in the people who come around the table together. To be part of the community is not just to make friends, it's to actually have access to God, the Holy Spirit dwelling among us. And so, if that is true, then to keep someone from that, or to have it be a more difficult path to get to that for some than others, isn't just a deprivation of their rights. It isn't just a hardship for them. It is, in fact, a scandal to the gospel. We are separating people from God. We are introducing this state of brokenness that is contrary to the promises of the scriptures and of our faith. And I would even go so far as to say that it's not just enough to say we're not doing the excluding. Say that, hey, I didn't say they couldn't come to church. That in fact, if it's true that people are being kept from the presence of Christ by the actions of anyone around us, then we have a proactive responsibility to work against that, to change that, to tear down the barriers. And to fail to do that, I will now use for the first time today the word sin. I cannot think of a greater sin than to stand idly by while someone else is being kept from God. Now, I don't mean to limit God. I don't mean to say that God can't find another way. God has and will. But that doesn't free us from the responsibility for it. So this, I think, is the theology that underlies the rest of what we'll talk about today, these practical steps toward transformation. What can we do as individuals and as a church to create a space that is welcoming and also to spread the word of God's welcome of all people? What are we called to do out in the community to create a more welcoming world? What does God call us to do so that people can experience the presence of the Spirit in their own lives? I think there's several elements of what that looks like, how we can live into the change that is required of us to make a difference, to be authentically welcoming. And the first is in the area of hospitality. Now, let me just put that out there. What does the word hospitality mean to you? What do you think hospitality is about? No wrong answers. Sharing space, that's very good. So like if you have a house and you invite someone into your living room, that is an act of hospitality. Yeah. What else? Expressing care. It's an act of compassion. So I agree, and particularly food when we're talking about church, right? I've already picked up that you do that part well here. That is what hospitality is. It is sharing. It is graciousness with what we have so that it is accessible to everyone else. I think we can do that with tangible things like food. I think we can do that with less tangible things like words, like our language, and like our time. As someone else said time. Our care for each other and how we are willing to devote this limited resource we have of our own space and being. So one of the ways that I think churches of today can give a lot of attention to hospitality is in the language we choose to use in worship. Since most of you don't write the liturgy in the church, so I am not just speaking to the pastors, but all of you can be part of thinking about how we worship together, whether you are in choirs or worship leaders or standing up to make an announcement in church. Language in worship is a really important part of how the church says this is who we are and this is what we're about. And that's true in our language of prayer, but it's also true in our language of just how we speak to one another. A lot of our church language is about invitation. And what do we often say when we're trying to say, all of you listen to me, how do I address you as a pastor? I invite you. You do this. What do I call you? Members? Friends? What?
Parishioners.
How many of you have ever been addressed as brothers and sisters in church? It used to be just brothers, brethren. But then we got pretty progressive and started saying brothers and sisters, or sisters and brothers. It's a perfectly acceptable way to speak. Except what have we learned today? Charlie says if you're non-binary, that doesn't apply to you. If you don't identify as a female or a male, you have now been unintentionally excluded. Now, I don't know that a person is necessarily going to leave the church because you've said that, but you can make a difference in reaching out and saying, I care enough about you as a person that I'm going to pay attention to that sort of thing. And this is where I have to really check myself, because I am a traditionalist, friends. If I would probably end up at like a Episcopal cathedral on Sunday mornings, you know, praying out of the Book of Common Prayer. But I have to let go of what I'm comfortable with sometimes out of hospitality. Because it isn't about me, it's about serving, sharing with another. And I think we can do that in a lot of other ways too. The images we choose to use for God, if they're exclusively masculine. And not only the gender of the language either. If the language is entirely militaristic, or if the language is entirely about authority and judgment and not the fullness of God as gracious and accepting. It's a lot of things we need to think about. Another act of hospitality involves, and this is something we spent a little time talking about this morning, the use of names and pronouns. And I'm so glad Charlie named that as part of his story here. A person who comes to the place in their life that they are able to say, this is who I am, this is the name I want to be called by, and these are my pronouns, has already showed a lot of courage to get to that place, and probably has endured a fair amount of struggle before being in that place. Your act of calling them by their name, and that is their name, not the name they want, it is their name. Your act of using their pronouns, not even their preferred pronouns, their pronouns, is an act of hospitality. It is what you would want for yourself, and it is the least we can do for our neighbor. And it's not a perfect parallel, but I guess I invite you to imagine yourself walking into a space like a church and having everybody address you by the wrong name and by the wrong gender. I just had this lovely lunch with Mary. And if I step away from Mary and I say, that was such a great lunch I just had with Mark.
That's my name right here.
with Mark. Oh. I mean, he was such a delight. Do you know Mark? Have you met Mark? He's great. Sorry to pick on you, Mary. It's awkward, though, isn't it? Exactly. It's almost comical, except that it wouldn't be comical if I wasn't trying to be comical. It would be offensive. It would be hurtful. It's that important. You've misgendered Charlie.
I know grasshopper.
And I think, I won't speak for Charlie, I think most transgender people will forgive you, but it's important that you're trying. And I'm so for the recording, I'm repeating some of this that Kim is acknowledging that she did this, points out that she was called out on it. Mary talks about how important that is, that she was called out, but also that Kim took responsibility. The other thing that I think is important is that, Kim, you apologized, but you also then moved on. One of the things that sometimes happens with people misgendering transgender folks is that suddenly becomes not about the transgender person who's been misgendered, but comes about you. I'm so sorry, please forgive me, let me get it right. Like, no, this isn't, you don't have to keep this alive. Move on. Don't center yourself. Let the person who has been misgendered forgive you, and it's done. When I misgender someone, and I still do, I correct myself, sometimes briefly apologize, and I move on. Because to draw more attention to it makes it about me and my need for healing and my reconciliation and my guilt, and I'm not the one who's been wronged. That makes sense? Probably a good guideline for apologies in general sometimes, right? The other thing that I think churches can do with regard to hospitality is about the physical space. So I've already had the opportunity to do a firsthand inspection of your restroom situation here. And you do something that I encourage every church to do. Every time there is a one-person bathroom, it should be a non-gendered bathroom or an all-gender bathroom. There is no reason for it not to be. And it's the easiest thing. A lot of churches, old churches, 100-year-old churches, were not aware of transgender issues when they were built. But most of them have a one-person bathroom or two. Sometimes they have it, it's the handicapped accessible bathroom. Those can always be gender inclusive. There is no reason they have to be gendered. Now, if you're building a new space or you have some flexibility, often you can even go further than that in thinking about spaces that do not arbitrarily assume a binary and separate people by genders with which all of your congregation may or may not identify. But sometimes if you don't have the flexibility, small steps are important. I am telling you that you should do this because it's the right thing to do, but it also is a very effective form of evangelism. There are people who will come to your church, and in something as simple as what you have put on the signs to your bathrooms, you have sent a message about the things that you care about. And it's a good thing. It shows that you are about hospitality. Does that make sense? Any questions about any of that? I am sure that if we had more time and all day, you could think of many more ways that churches can show in their words and their acts hospitality. But let's move on to another one. Visibility. So I think when churches undertake to be more intentionally welcoming, one of the things that they really get stuck on sometimes is the how to show people on the outside what they think they are on the inside. And it's a real sticky wicket. We talked about it, again, my lunch table. It was a very rich conversation at my lunch table. One way that churches can choose to show hospitality, I mean to show visibility, to make visible their commitment to welcome, is with outward signs or symbols. What you put on your sign, what you hang over the door. What are some examples of ways that you could visibly express your welcome? The rainbow flag, the pride flag. Now, what are the pros and cons of doing that? Can get stolen, that's a con, yes. Actually, I can also get caught in the gutter. The church, Stone Church in San Jose Presbytery, it's in Willow Glen. I was speaking there a couple years ago, and they have a pride flag, and it was like as I arrived, it was blown up onto the roof and kind of down in the gutter. It was like, well, that's not the message you want to say. They're a very welcoming church. The pride flag is a clear indicator that you are a welcoming church to LGBTQIA plus people. It does something that the banner that says all are welcome does not. Now, here's what I will say, though. It also conveys a certain spirit, attitude of welcome, a proactivity of welcome, that you want to make absolutely sure is true before you put up the banner. The worst thing you can do is undertake these steps of visibility and more or less lure people into your church, only to find out that they aren't as fully welcome there as you thought they were. So one of the things I encourage a church to do before you start taking those steps, and I actually do think those are good steps to take for a lot of churches, but is to make sure that you've had enough conversation with your church leadership and with your congregation as a whole, that they understand what that symbol means, and that you've had enough opportunity of conversation about it that you know what the reaction is going to be when that openly gay couple, when that transgender person comes through the door. Because the worst thing you can do is suggest to them they'll be welcomed, the person who's been hurt before by the church, and then have them come and get hurt again. Having said that, I don't think people will believe that you're welcoming if you don't tell them explicitly that LGBTQ people are welcomed. You don't have to do it with a rainbow flag if that's a symbol that doesn't work for you. There's other ways. There's also ways that you can go out into the community and do things that send a visible message of welcome that are not just about a label. These are more in the pride flag, even though it is a flag and not a word, is more in that category of words to me. It sends a message. But I think actions sometimes speak louder than words. So at our lunch table, we were talking about marching in a pride parade. Why would a church march in a pride parade? Why would straight people from a church march in a pride parade? Because they're allies. You are saying, we're not all gay here, we're not saying that, but you will find people who will walk with you in this journey. We're not all transgender here, but we will walk with the queer community. What you're maybe saying even less specifically than that is that there are people, Christians, who will walk with you. And sometimes these things are worth doing even if they don't attract a single person to your Sunday worship service. These are not all evangelism strategies, church growth strategies. Sometimes they're just the right thing to do. Show compassion and love, which is the gospel, by being in places that people wouldn't expect you to be. First Presbyterian Church of New York City is on Fifth Avenue. It's on the route of the New York City Pride Parade, which, as you may know, has thousands and thousands of people. It is a huge event. They invited me to preach there in 2013 on Pride Sunday, which happened to come 3 days after the Supreme Court approved Obergefell. Yeah, why am I not coming to? Yes, the same-sex marriage case. and the Windsor case as well, which was obviously a pretty big day for the New York City Pride Parade that year. The church has had a ministry, though, for the last 40 years during the Pride Parade of going out to the parade route, and you know they line it with these metal barricades that you can't get through that separates the crowds from the parade participants. But the police leave a space about this big in front of the church. And what they do with that space is that the church, throughout the entire two-hour, three-hour process of the parade, fills cups with water, and members of the church and all the ministers, in their clerical garb, in their robes and their stoles, throughout the day, take cups of water out to the people marching in the parade, who are usually pretty hot and tired by then. I got to do that. And I have to tell you, you would have thought that I was handing them stacks of $10,000 bills. You would have thought that I was telling them every good news of the gospel line, and that they were going directly to heaven, and that they had never heard any of that before. There were tears. There were hugs. They couldn't believe. And this was 2013. This wasn't 1975. They couldn't believe that the church was showing that act of compassion, which was as simple as a cool cup of water. The church spoke the gospel that day. I doubt those people showed up at the First Presbyterian Church of New York City the next week. But that's not the point. I also would invite you to think about the impact that doing acts of visibility, whether it's participating in a PFLAG group in town or going to Pride Festival or hosting, as I know you have, a Transgender Day of Remembrance service, those kinds of activities don't just have an impact on the queer community. They also have an impact on your community. Another church I know, First Presbyterian Church of Boise, Idaho, actually the church that Marcy Glass, the new pastor at Calvary Presbyterian in San Francisco, who's being installed tomorrow, it's her prior church. They participate in Pride every year. They have for many years. They made T-shirts one year that say, Jesus loves you, we think you're fabulous. They have a couple people who are designated to stand at their booth in the tent, and it says, come to receive an apology from the church. And they let people come and tell them how they've been hurt, and they give them a hug and apologize. They have on the table in their booth a tablecloth spread, a white sheet, and Sharpies, and they invite people to say whatever they want to say to the church. And sometimes people write, I miss you. Some people write vulgarities. And it's filled with words. And what they did at First Presbyterian Church, it's not First, it was Southminster Presbyterian of Boise. They took it the next Sunday and put it on the communion table. Spread it as the tablecloth under the communion elements. Bringing the transgender and gay and lesbian community right there to the Lord's table, participating with them, God's people. I don't know if that was an act of visibility for the queer community or for the church, but it can be both. The other way that churches can, and I would say really have to, express the visibility of LGBTQ people is by fully involving them in the life of the church. Fully. So yes, we voted on the ordination debate. So yes, they can serve as deacons and elders. We voted on same-sex marriage. Yes, they can be married. But it's more than that. It's teaching Sunday school. It's offering pastoral care. It's lighting the Advent candles. You know, Advent candles do not have to be lit by a mom and dad and two children. Did you know that? It is every time we make a decision to celebrate the identity of one of God's children, we are proclaiming good news. We are changing the church. We are changing this 2,000-year-old message of oppression and separation and exclusion. It has an impact. The third category of things that I think we can do, practically speaking, to live into change are words and acts of publicity. And I guess this is, publicity sounds only slightly more theological than advertising or marketing. But it's a very practical consideration, right? How do we send the message if we have done the work, but nobody knows about it? What good is it to have done it? But how do we do it in a way that is actually effective and honors the people who we're trying to speak to? A lot of churches really wrestle with and sometimes are consumed by a debate over welcoming statements, what it is they say, boiling down their commitment to inclusion to one paragraph or one sentence. I want to say on this subject, not to mention all the other subjects we've talked about, pronouns, vocabulary, what L and G and B and T stand for, on all of those points, I don't want you to get consumed by the details to the extent that you miss the broader point, which is love and compassion. But having said that, words do matter. So if words matter, what words should we say when we're trying to tell people that we're welcoming? Let me stop and see if you have any thoughts. First Presbyterian Church is what? Is a community that what? Where all are welcome. Seek to share Christ's love. You ground what you are theologically. What do you say about sexual orientation and gender identity? It's harder. It's harder to make it roll off the tongue smoothly. You may have to sacrifice pithiness. You may not be able to fit everything on a banner. But let me encourage you to go to the trouble of thinking about what words you would include if you could. And I think you might be surprised at all the places you can include them. If you don't mention sexual orientation and gender identity, LGBTQ people won't believe that it's something you care about. Laura? Mm-hmm. I think that's an excellent model. So one of the places you do it is in worship. What? And the source. Yeah, there's a lot of words that don't have gender that can be used. Yeah. I will repeat all of what Laura said. Do you want to share what church you go to? You don't. I'm not putting you on the spot. Oh, Grace Presbyterian Lodi. What Laura said is that the pastor often at the beginning of worship specifically says, this is a church where all are welcome, people of all races, gender expression, gender identities, sexual orientations, specifically naming those things on Sunday morning when welcoming people. Also is intentional about using more than one pronoun for God, and sometimes using words other than pronouns for God, other than gendered images, like the source. And also, what was the last part you shared, Laura? On his email. He identifies himself by his pronouns, which similar, I think, to gender-inclusive bathroom signs, without having to say so, sends a message of things that you think are important. And by the way, let me divert from that just to say for a moment, if you are a cisgender person who you don't think really needs to share your pronouns because everybody can look at you and know your pronouns, I invite you to consider doing it anyway. Because what you do is you normalize the sharing of pronouns so that people who maybe do need to do that, so to help people understand their identity, don't have to feel like they're being singled out or made the exception. That is also an act of hospitality. So my email signature, you don't have to make a big deal about it. My email signature says, Brian Ellison, parentheses, he, him, his, executive director, Covenant Network of Presbyterians. It's not that hard. Those are all great examples. And I think it is really important that that's happening in worship. But it's not the only place it should happen. Cheryl. What do you do with the Lord's Prayer? Say it. No. I don't think every reference to Father is bad. And I want to be clear that I'm not saying that. I think that our language for God and our language in worship should express the fullness of the diversity of the Scripture and of our understanding of God, which is to say that God is more than like a father to us. The same scriptures refer to God as being like the mother hen who gathers her chicks. The same scriptures refer to God as the source of all being. And I will say in particular, Father is one I think we should be careful with, because some people have had pretty negative experiences with fathers. So whatever we think we're accomplishing by saying, hey, think of God as Father, that isn't the same experience for everybody. Having said that, the Lord's Prayer occupies a particular liturgical traditional space. I don't think you have to jettison it completely, but I think it can't be the only way we talk about God. Yeah, and do you feel like you've, has your relationship with God been damaged by your doing that? No? Right. Abba. Right. And let's, this goes back to our earlier conversation about the Bible. Is the Bible a rule book, a checklist, a manual that is not, or is it a collection of ancient wisdom inspired by the Holy Spirit to prompt us in our journey with God? In which case, of course we would depart from that original language and talk about some other things, and it would expand and grow and be richer and fuller than we ever imagined. Cheryl. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think the question is, should we rethink celebrating Mother's and Father's Day in church? I'm not saying you can't celebrate those things, but I think everything we do needs to be done with sensitivity, right? So certainly Mother's Day is a great example of a day that I know a lot of women who are not mothers, or whose mothers have died, or whose children have died, or who have trouble with that day. So I think we need to think about those things. And certainly if there are ways that our celebrations are excluding people, we certainly should be giving thought to how we can do that differently. Laura's suggestions for what her pastor does to express welcome speaks to what we might do in church. And those same statements could be, for example, printed on the front of your bulletin. Which, you know, as the person walking in, oh, I am welcome here. It says so right here. That's very powerful. But it only works on the people who actually come to the church. So you have to also think about other places you might say those things. And one of those places is your website. And maybe this is already obvious to you, but in case it is not, I will say so. Most people are not coming to a church anymore without visiting the website of the church. They're in charge of the web. God says the web. See, I knew it. In fact, not only are they probably visiting your website, they're probably searching every page of your website. They're looking at old sermons, they're looking at videos of worship, they're looking at pictures of your sanctuary, they're looking for what you offer for children and families. And if they, not just LGBTQ people, many people are going to be looking at what you say about sexuality and gender and your commitment to welcome. So, just like with the rainbow flag, don't say things on your website that aren't true, but if they are true, don't be afraid to say them on your website. I want to raise one other question that someone did at lunch, which is, what about the fact that some people might be offended by marching in the Pride Parade or putting the welcoming statement on the website? What do you say about that? Well, I think everything we do should be done with sensitivity and compassion. I think we should certainly work to educate and listen to people who have differing views. It is possible that there might be some things that you would decide to do as a congregation that will not make everyone happy. That on the one hand, some people might be so unhappy, they might be angry or leave. But I guess what I want to ask you to consider, if that is the situation you're operating under, is two things. First, how authentic is the connection that that person has with your congregation if the thing that would keep them from sharing in fellowship, sharing in ministry with you, sharing in these relationships you've spent all these years building, is what you put on your website, or what flag you hang outside the door, or what parade you march in? Maybe the brokenness has already happened. The second thing I'd say, and I don't mean to be flippant about that, I don't mean to say that that's not real, but I'm asking you to consider a hard question. The second thing I'd say is that if the choice, if you're going to lose someone, and the choice is between losing the person who has been comfortable all their life in your community, or the person who has been hurt by the church, the person who has been excluded, the person who is in a place of pain, who is the church called to bend over backwards to serve? Yes, Laura was listening earlier this morning. The marginalized, the oppressed, the one on the outside. Not the 99. And so, I'm not trying to be jerk about this. I'm not trying to caricature this situation. I know that I'm still talking about real people, not issues, including the longtime church member who might leave. That is a real person as well. And if I were the pastor, or even if I weren't the pastor, if I were a member of the church, I would do everything I could to reach out to them, help them know they are loved and cared for. But at the end of the day, the church doesn't exist to protect the comfortable. It doesn't exist to keep everything peaceful, to avoid conflict. it exists to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ to all people. And sometimes that makes some people uncomfortable. There's biblical stories about that as well. The elder brother in the parable of the prodigal son was not very happy with the father in that story. He did, and I believe there were some consequences to Jesus for that. So, that's how I end up. I don't want to see anyone leave. And I was a pastor of a church for 13 years. I had people leave, not over anything so important as this, let me assure you. But, and it doesn't make me happy, and it's painful, and I lay awake nights worrying about it. It's not easy. But sometimes we have to act with conviction, and it's hard. Ashley? I think that is another act of publicity, is getting on those lists, being known as the safe churches. One of the ways you do that is what I'm probably going to talk about next, which is being part of organizations like the Covenant Network of Presbyterians. But those aren't the only ones, and also More Light Presbyterians. There are listings of gay-affirming churches that are non-denominational, that it's probably important to be on if that's who you are, but only if that's who you are. The final step of publicity that I'll just quickly mention is acts of public witness, and by that I mean when the city council is debating a non-discrimination ordinance, when the local school district is considering a anti-transgender policy with regard to girls' sports, when your state legislature is debating equal rights acts in housing and employment, those are moments for churches to have a real impact. And it is particularly important for churches that support those things to speak up because, as you know, the overwhelming media presentation of the Christian position on those issues is that it is anti-LGBT. I think one thing I will say is I know in California you actually do have a fairly good history of a church coalition, of church coalitions coming together around those issues from time to time. But I don't know if that's true in your community, and even if it's already true with other churches, that's a team you want to be part of. So finally, I do want to say a few words about the Covenant Network of Presbyterians, and then I think we'll have plenty of time for some questions. The Covenant Network has been doing this work for 24 years. We are not the only ones doing the work, and it is possible for churches to be good churches without engaging with the Covenant Network. Having said that, I think we offer a certain set of resources and help that is valuable, and that I hope to deepen this connection that we've made that has culminated in today's conversation. This is our mission statement. the call to covenant community. Pro tip for those of you who put together PowerPoint presentations, never put that many words on one slide. That is not how you do this. But you can find that on our website. What I will highlight for you is that that statement has evolved a few times since our founding, but it's always been the way that a church becomes part of the covenant network is for its session to affirm this statement. And the statement in its present form, which is just a couple of years old, acknowledges that the church has made real progress, and we're happy about that, but that we still have a long way to go, that there's a lot of work to do. And we've committed ourselves. There was a time when the Covenant Network's main role was trying to change church policy at General Assembly, political advocacy, more or less, trying to win votes. Today, what we are really about is not winning votes, but winning hearts and minds. It's about equipping and educating and engaging with churches and presbyteries to do this work and to create more welcoming spaces. We do that in a number of different ways. But first, let me tell you how you can be involved in our work. Church sessions can affirm the call to covenant community. You can share with us the proactive steps you're taking. I wouldn't know about the things that First Presbyterian of New York City or Southminster Boise or Trinity Atlanta is doing if they didn't share that with us or invite us to be part of that. And then I'm able to tell other churches about it to inspire them. So in putting the network into Covenant Network is really important right now. We encourage churches to support this work in the whole church. As much good work as you have done, as much leadership as you have in Pastor Ashley, there are plenty of churches that do not have that leadership and do not have that work. And by getting involved with the Covenant Network, with your prayers and with your financial support, you are actually helping other churches beyond your own, which means you're helping other LGBTQ people in all the parts of the country, even the ones you will never meet. So that really makes a difference. And sharing what works is really important. Some of what we're doing is a series of events called the Covenant Conversations. There was a time when the Covenant Network was very invested in big national conferences, and hundreds of people would come to our conferences in the years where we were getting ready for big votes and big debates. We kept doing those for a while, but what we realized is that the same people would come to those almost every time, and they were mostly clergy who had the expense accounts to fly somewhere and go to a conference. And we don't think they were accomplishing what we needed to accomplish at this moment in the church's life. What needs to be accomplished is people coming together like this. And I'm particularly excited that there are people from more than one congregation here, because I don't think any one church does this alone. They do it when they come together, listen to each other. Some are further down the road than others, and they can share resources, and they can share support and encouragement. They can share prayers. So these covenant conversations are regional-focused events, usually through a presbytery, that bring congregations together. They're usually on a Saturday, like this, sometimes over a weekend. Sometimes they're in connection with a presbytery meeting. Sometimes they're just an event hosted at a church. But in every case, they are designed to provide a combination of worship and education, and encouragement, hope for the future. And we just had our first one post-pandemic in Charlotte, North Carolina last month. We had about 40 people in person and another 30 or so online in a hybrid arrangement, people mostly from the Charlotte area online, and it was a great gift, and I think will have impact for years to come. And so we're trying to look for places to have those around the country, and I'm happy to talk more about that if anyone wants to talk about that here. Other things we're working on in this year ahead, we're expanding access to our resources. So our website is full of all this stuff over 24 years of this work. Some of it is still relevant, some of it isn't, but it's a treasure trove, And we want more people to use it and have it. So we're devoting a lot of time in the next year to making these resources more available and accessible and being having people be able to get what they need. We're also trying to make those resources more video format friendly because that's just like I told you about websites visits. That's how a lot of people are finding their way through these issues today. We also, in the year ahead, are really committing to trying to develop the kinds of relationships we have across the Presbyterian Church USA with the Presbyterian Church USA's partners around the world. There are churches debating these issues all over the world, and in some cases, as you may know, churches are on the wrong side of protecting the rights and safety of LGBTQ people in churches around in countries around the world. We're trying to find ways to support the Presbyterian Church's mission co-workers to live out the promises of our own church's commitments in wherever they are serving. And so we have been in intentional conversations this year with the Presbyterian World Mission Area. We're meeting with mission co-workers, and we're finding ways that our experience can be a blessing to others around the world. And finally, right now, the one thing that has been true almost from the beginning with us is that we play another role that's harder to put on paper, harder to explain, but essentially we are a place that people call when they're in crisis. Candidates for ministry, inquirers, ministers seeking a call, PNCs, pastor nominating committees, that want to be inclusive in their search but don't know where to look, executive presbyters who call and ask for assistance with particular situations. I get a call like that every week from someone, sometimes more than one a week. And that's a valuable resource that the Covenant Network has played for years and continues to play. And that is what churches that support us and individuals make possible. Yes, the pandemic caused us to do all kinds of interesting things we didn't do before. But we did offer sermons from not only me, but several of our board members who offered those up as video sermons. And I'm embarrassed to say that I have preached in more churches in the past 18 months when nobody was meeting than I had in my previous 7 years in the job. But it is that was a silver lining, I guess, of the pandemic, and it was a service that we were glad to be able to provide free of charge to all the churches in the country that wanted a word that was affirming of LGBTQ people and also was the gospel. Finally, as promised, what has the General Assembly done for us lately? What happened after the votes on ordination and marriage? I put this last rather than back in the history from this morning because I do want to move toward concluding with a word of hope. Some good things are happening. And one of the things that happened in 2018, as I mentioned this morning, was that the church took actions to say, for the first time in some cases, that we as a church are going to be affirming, not just permissive. We're not just going to allow this. We're going to celebrate people's gifts. We're going to affirm the dignity and humanity of all people. And so they took this action in 2018, which said that it was out of a conviction that all people are created in the image of God and that the gospel is good news for all people. This assembly affirms the full dignity and the full humanity of transgender people, their full inclusion in all human rights, and their giftedness for service. And it went on to call on churches and all church agencies to seek to continually expand their welcome. So if I have not convinced you, let the General Assembly convince you. All churches are called to expand their welcome. And we would never have said that a few years ago. I'm happy to tell you, not only did we say it, we said it unanimously. This was on the consent agenda. People had an opportunity to pull it off the consent agenda, and nobody did. They were ready for this to go without the commentary and the hurtful things that would have been said in the past, the debate that Some people even left the church over. They said, we're not doing that anymore. This is what's true. And not only transgender people's dignity, but they also passed another motion that celebrated the gifts of people of diverse sexual orientations and gender identities. It said, we've been doing this for 10 years now, well, 7 years then, ordaining LGBTQ people openly, legally. And we did a good job. They're using their gifts. That's to celebrate, and that's what the assembly said. But it also called on us again to continually seek to expand our welcome. The work isn't done. So before we go, I want to invite you to share signs of hope that you see. And I think we've already heard some today. Thank you, Charlie. How has being welcomed changed the life of someone you know? Or how has it changed your church? How has the gospel been faithfully proclaimed? Does anyone want to share? Laura? This will be perfect. Thank you, Laura.
Well, for personally, when we welcomed a new pastor, I specifically, along with my child, went and met with him to directly ask him his position on these issues. And I had already decided I will do whatever for my child, and I was willing to leave my lifelong church if he wasn't. And he was, which made me cry. But but also, it changed it for my child, who started attending church with me again.
Gift. I feel like we should respond for this gift. Let us say thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. What else? Yeah. Would you? Thank you. We'll get you a microphone. Round the baptismal font, past the pillars. Old church.
By the way, this is Reverend Melissa from Trinity. Yes. So I don't know that, especially because of COVID, especially I don't know if my congregation has gotten a chance to meet you yet, but this is my dear colleague from our beloved sister church across town, or sibling church.
Good.
Even
good,
that,
very good.
Look at that. See, it happens. Fellow child of Christ, church across town.
Beloved of God. So I would love to tell you just a short little moment from my own coming out story. I'm not going to tell you the whole thing because, as you might guess from looking at me, it's a long story. I started coming out, you know, in the last century. And I sometimes do, when I do workshops and stuff, I sometimes say that coming out is the queer superpower. Because what coming out actually means is that most of us spend a period of time in our life, you know, trying to make some decisions about who we really are and how true to ourselves we're going to be and how many risks we're going to take and with what kind of ethics we're going to live out who we are. And I think you straight people should work on coming out a little bit, too. But I think maybe today what's happening is that First Presbyterian is working on its coming out story. And I'm really, really proud of you for that and grateful for your witness. So I want to tell you about the first gay pride event I ever went to. It was probably 1979, and I had just done the thing that all Southern queer kids do, is to get themselves to Atlanta, Georgia, where they will be in a place that's a little bit safer. I just graduated from college, put everything I owned in the back seat of my 1968 Plymouth Valiant and got to Atlanta. And I went to my first gay pride event in Piedmont Park, and it was just a swirl of color and music and people, and there were all these like little booths where people were handing out flyers about, you know, the Feminist Women's Health Center and Karis, a lesbian feminist bookstore, and you know, the Gay Men's Chorus, and all this amazing stuff was a whole new world. I had no idea. I certainly also did not know there was anything like a welcoming and inclusive church. I was from a mostly Southern Baptist and Methodist religious background, and after having felt not so welcome in the church a few times, I really didn't want anything to do with the church. So as I was getting ready to leave the park, I saw these people with a little, you know, folding table and a sign that said something about Christians Concerned. And I decided to give them a really wide berth because everything that I had ever heard about Christians Concerned was generally not good. It generally meant some really right-wing agenda. So I tried my best to give them the slip, but did you know, man, those people were good. And as I... As I was coming down the path, somebody stuck a little pamphlet in my hand, and it looked like one of those tracts, you know, that they hand out sometimes that basically end up telling you you're going to hell. And I was like, oh, man, you know. I stuck it in my pocket. I went around and did the rest of the party and everything. I had a great time. I got home that night, and my pockets were just bulging with things from these exciting places I'd visited. And as I'm emptying out my pockets, I come across the tract that said on its cover, "What Jesus Christ had to say about homosexuality." And I thought, oh boy, you didn't get away, did you? But I opened it up just to see how bad it was, you know. I was doom scrolling in a
before there was scrolling. Yes, yeah. That's good.
And the inside of the tract, of course, was completely blank. There were no words inside. And I flipped it over, and on the back it said, "That's right. Jesus didn't say anything about homosexuality. He did, however, tell us to love God and love neighbor. And that's what we're going to try to work on." Now the reason, the reason I'm standing here today as an ordained Presbyterian minister has to do with an awful lot of stuff, some of which happened before I was born, and the work of the Holy Spirit, and a lot of experiences, and good people. But let me tell you, friends, when I got that tract, I did not know there was such a thing as liberal Christianity. And that was the first moment, the first little crack in my awareness that there was a place out there for me. There was a place where not only was I welcomed, but where eventually I was called and claimed to tell the good news over and over again, as often as I can, wherever I can. Those folks were one part of my coming out story, and I'm really grateful to them for it. And I'm grateful I got another chance to tell it to you today.
I am grateful you got another chance to tell it again today, Melissa. And you should seriously consider a career in preaching, I think.
Also, she has written all kinds of books on storytelling and things, and you can see it right there. Goodness. Those are a lot of really beautiful questions that would take a lot of, that were up there. Brian, thank you so much. I will just say one of the things that was a great joy for me in that how it changes you is I think sometimes... us straighties can think that
it's not a term we use,
you know, really. But well, or those who haven't worked through a lot of these things or haven't needed to, of course, then we do, though, right? Because people we love, it becomes very personal, as it should. I just want to share one of the things in terms of how it's changed me is being in communities that were open and affirming, realizing the deep joy. Because I think that so many Christians live with this fragmented sense of deeply loving and caring for folks who are part of the LGBTQIA plus community, and then feeling, and then yeah, going to church and not having them there, you know, and figuring, just trying to figure that out. But the deep joy of not being fragmented, right? Because I relate and so appreciate the idea of it's coming out too as a church, you know, in terms of saying this is a place where we celebrate, you know, or just being a part, the communities that I've been a part of. I know my internship church down in LA, just the joy of feeling the wholeness of welcome in all parts of my life for my siblings, the beloved children of Christ from all different gender identities. There's a lightness and a freeness that I feel as a follower of Christ to come along the table with folks, all kinds of folks. So I will just say, yeah, so it's for the whole church. It's for all of us. It's not just, you know, for the like you bring those who are marginalized to the table, and now everybody gets to hear that many more stories and that much more richness, that much more theological understanding of the Bible. Whoa. You know, and I recognize that, yeah, anyway, I could talk for a long time. You guys know.
I'm grateful.
But one way I've been changed, I know.
Thank you, Ashley. Thank you for sharing that. I feel like there's more stories to share, and I'm glad we're stopping now because I don't want all the stories to be shared today. I want this to be an ongoing conversation. And I hope it's a conversation that includes the church in Lodi and the church down the street and different parts of this church, including people who aren't here today. I hope it's a conversation that involves not just pastors, but lay people, that involves folks maybe who didn't come today because they don't agree. I want this to be an ongoing conversation. That's the only way it changes, and it's the only way the church grows and deepens. I also hope the conversation will continue with, that I can continue this conversation with you. If you have other questions that come up, if you have other ways you think I can be of service or the Covenant Network's resources can be of use to you, please don't hesitate to ask. There's my email address and even my cell phone number. Did I put that on? Okay, well, now you have my cell phone number and our website. I also have some business cards if you want that. If you have not yet put your email address on that sign-up sheet out by the door, that will help ensure that you find out more about what we're working on. And finally, I do have some envelopes. I have some here on the table, and there's some out now by that sign-up sheet. There's no pressure, but if you feel moved to support this work that allows me to come to places like Stockton and would allow me to come to other places in the future, I would be most grateful for your financial support as well. This has been an incredible privilege and joy for me, and I hope to get to spend more time with you in the future. Can I close us in prayer? Would that be all right? Let us pray. Eternal God, you have blessed us beyond measure. You have made the world out of nothing, and out of nothing, this world you have made has become a display of immense beauty and richness. Diverse in appearance, diverse on the inside and the outside, full of goodness. God, for the ways that we have not always appreciated that goodness, forgive us. For the ways that we have perpetuated old injustices, hear our prayers. But God, for the ways that you are at work among us, for the ways that you are empowering us to new ways of thinking and living and being, we give you thanks and praise. Help us as individuals, help our congregations, help our larger church, Presbyterian and beyond, to more faithfully each day represent your goodness, that we would not be a scandal to the gospel, but we would be proclaimers of it. May all of your people your LGBTQIA plus people, and all of us. Be blessed and be a blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all so much.